Because I got the world and I got my niggas like, what you gonna do, Cole?
Last weekend, during his headlining set for the Dreamville Festival, rapper J. Cole expressed regret over his diss track, 7-Minute Drill. The track directed at Kendrick Lamar was removed from streaming platforms this weekend and shortened the Big 3 to just the Big 2. Talk around Cole's apology has been rampant in the hip-hop community, with opinions decisive. The sympathetic narratives on Cole's enlightenment highlight a larger theme of his coddling in the rap game.
Every year, I write a battle rhyme for the entire top 10 of Billboard. No disrespect, it's just the way I practice.
Donkey of the Day for Monday, April 8th goes to all of you that are disappointed that J. Cole apologized to Kendrick Lamar.
How many people think Kendrick Lamar is one of the greatest motherfuckers to ever touch a fucking microphone?
What you did last night, every nigga that's that nigga in the culture that you're in, trust and believe they looking at you a different way today.
But the truth is, no, it's like I use meditation now as like, I say it as like an emergency break glass thing.
J. Cole entered the 2010s rap scene contrary to Kendrick Lamar and more like Drake, with a key co-sign and backing from hip-hop's the gatekeeper, Jay-Z. Cole signed to Jay-Z's Roc Nation in 2009 and was the label's first artist. Roc Nation was Jay-Z's second attempt at label ownership and another milestone in his pursuit of black capitalism. 3 years prior, J. Cole was a college graduate from St. John's University, actively pursuing his rap career with slow progress. His first encounter with Jay-Z is now a canon story for his steadfast fan base. After finishing his first mixtape, The Come Up, Cole decided to find Jay-Z and pass the tape personally to him, who at the time was recording his 10th studio album, American Gangsta. Cole hoped after Jay-Z listened to his mixtape, he would eventually get signed and maybe even featured on the album. Reflecting on their first encounter from an ABC News special in 2009, J. Cole said, "Maybe we could just slide him the CD, and if we slide him the CD, he'll go upstairs and listen to it. And if he listens to it, he's gonna love it. And he's gonna send down, you know, for me to come upstairs, and he's probably gonna sign me," or whatever was in my head. He waited in the rain outside Jay-Z's New York studio for hours and received a rejection on the spot. Their relationship since then is peculiar. To the average hip-hop listener, perhaps a newer Cole fan, it's a connection that's comfortably forgotten. The two men seem to have nourished their relationship behind the scenes rather than in the public eye. A far cry from Lil Wayne's mentorship of Drake, which saw the two work on numerous collabs. Jay-Z and J. Cole have released only two songs together, Mr. Nice Watch and A Star Is Born. Their relaxed public-facing relationship was intentional for both rappers, as Jay-Z was developing and managing artists differently compared to Rockefeller and his new 28 venture, Roc Nation. Cole, on the other hand, was hesitant about the Jay-Z cosign overshadowing his talent and his ability to succeed alone. 2024's J. Cole is very different from the rapper we were first introduced to, especially through the lens of the 2010s rap class. Every year since the death of hip-hop's golden age in the 80s and 90s, commenters and onlookers, usually not embedded in the culture, love to remind you the genre is dying or already dead, only for a new talent to emerge or a legend to return that restores the faith in the game. The early to mid-2010s, especially rap superstars who rose to prominence, were hip-hop's other golden age. For the 2010 XXL freshman class, J. Cole appeared on the list alongside with Wiz Khalifa, Big Sean, Nipsey Hussle, Freddie Gibbs, J-Rock, and others. Nicki Minaj and Drake were already so hugely successful at the time that they both declined their 2010 placements and opted for separate covers. 2011's freshman class saw the likes of Kendrick Lamar, Meek Mill, Big Kirk, Mac Miller, and YG. 2012 with Future, French Montana, Iggy Azalea, and finally 2013 and 2014 with Schoolboy Q, Absol, Travis Scott, Logic, Joey Badass, Chance the Rapper, Ty Dolla $ign, Lil Bibby, Kevin Gates, and many others. The 2010s class was vast, diverse, and competitive. And while recently Cole has been placed in rap's mythical Big 3, back then he wasn't the presumptive star like Kendrick Lamar and Drake. Cole's posturing from some fans as profound is intriguing, considering he's a rather simple lyricist in comparison to 2010's all-star lineup. Compared to rappers who are also extremely good writers like Kendrick Lamar and Nicki Minaj, he fails to incorporate elaborate literary schemes. Nicki Minaj's favorite literary device is homophones, words that pronounce alike but with different meanings. For example, look at her very clever verse from Yo Gotti's Rake It Up.
Pink Lamborghini, just a race with China. What the race to China? Just a race in China. Little bad trendy bitch, but she mixed with China.
Kendrick Lamar is a Pulitzer-winning poet who loves alliterations, allusions, repetitions, and imagery. J. Cole's supposed deepness is not found in his writing, but more so of his content. Speaking to NPR in 2011, he said, "I started off on a military base, and I remember moving. I guess this was after my parents got divorced. From there to a trailer park, it was one of the scary places I had been to, because I was always worried about my mother. Around the 5th or 6th grade, I moved from there to a nicer house, where I had my own room. So I saw life at all levels. I'm half black, half white, so I basically put it like this. I can fit in anywhere. That's why I write so many stories from different perspectives, because I've seen so many." His discography further highlights his above average talents and not gold status acclaim. His classic album is actually his 2010 mixtape, Friday Night Lights, which saw his best attempt at the full package, lyricism, beats, and production. His meditation era with the 2014 Forest Hills Drive saw his highest selling album and more themed storytelling. Taking a step back to reflect on fame, and release an album on his own terms. Then came 2021's surprisingly scale offseason, which saw Cole reckon with his potential falloff in the rap game, and finally claim he was indeed worthy of GOAT status. Other releases in between these three eras have strengths and lows. His debut album, Cole World, The Sideline Story, was underwhelming, with Cole succumbing to label pressure, but Workout, the lead single, is still a good song. KOD was a righteous and conscious Cole, but just superficially. Born Sinner and For Your Eyes Only are solid projects, but For Your Eyes Only being the better project and an underrated album from Cole's catalog.
That nigga's a sweetheart for real.
I don't know him.
He's a fruit pop for real.
You know, he sells like no records. He hasn't even came out yet.
I can't even see how a kid could look at Ja Rule and want to be like Ja Rule.
Maybe it's the nonchalant way he's plucking the guitar strings while he talks, but Cole's presence has the same effect as strong indica. Everyone's relaxed and in a heady space, trying to draw profound conclusions from pop culture. It feels like a glimpse of how Cole must have held core in his dorm room at St. John's University in Queens. A little self-serious, a little goofy, reasonably asserting that he's right. Every sapiosexual's wet dream, basically. Allison P. Davis, GQ. In her fall 2023 interview for Complex magazine, rapper Noname, continuing her rollout and press tour for her second studio album, Sundial, spoke about her 2020 beef, or spirited debate, as writer Jordan Rose wrote. Reflecting on the incident, Noname is much more good-natured about the whole ordeal, stating, "I think we both could have went about it in a better way. But I love how you called it a spirited debate, because it really wasn't like a diss. It was like, I have an ideological disagreement with you. I'm gonna write about it on a song," which is like, we're grown as hell. We both could have done better. I'm like, bro, I'm only on Twitter. I'm not even talking about you. While Noname has moved on from the event, the spirited debate is an important timestamp in Cole's career and the landscape of hip-hop, especially for femme hip-hop heads, particularly black women. Snow in the Bluff was a solo track and conceivable diss track aimed at Noname, released on June 16, 2020, the summer of COVID and racial tensions globally. Cole has vehemently downplayed the diss part, but the evidence is damning. Initially opening verse 1 with compliments for Noname, but then swiftly questions her queen tone due to his intellectual insecurities. The track was released a few weeks after Noname's tweet calling out hip-hop so-called conscious rappers. Poor black folks all over the country are putting their bodies on the line in protest for our collective safety, and your all-favorite top-selling rappers not even willing to put a tweet up. Niggas' whole discographies be about black plight, and they know where to be found, she tweeted.
The media.
The griot uplifts the ideology that all rap is and can be conscious. The distinction between conscious and non-conscious rappers is the white gaze on black art, as noted by Andre G in his 2020 Substack post on the topic. Made famous by American novelist Toni Morrison, the white gaze is the assumption that the default reader or observer is coming from perspective of someone who identifies themselves as white, which can alter the way the artists perceive and how artists continue to create. NBA Youngboy's trauma and rags to riches lyrics are as conscious as Kendrick Lamar rapping about his Compton upbringing and Good Kid, Mad City. Noname, out of the 2010s highly political class, is by far the best. Her activism moves beyond just verses, but community building in her city of Chicago. In her masterpiece Sundial, she boldly called out black capitalism and America's police state through references to Jay-Z and Beyonce. Her consciousness has been nursed because she reads the radical liberation works and encourages others to do the same through the Noname Book Club. Cole's track, Snow on the Bluff, is titled after a 2011 documentary of the same name. The documentary set in Atlanta follows drug dealer Curtis Snow and his captivating crime life. The documentary and lifestyle portrayed by Snow in the film was later revealed to be heavily exaggerated and mostly fabricated, a symbol for false prophets as noted by Jalen Washington May's article on the Cole diss track, an ultimately important theme throughout the song.
How you gonna lead when you attacking the very same niggas that really do need the shit that you saying? Instead of conveying you holier, come help us get her to speed. Shit, it's a reason it's like 200 years.
Along with acknowledging his full deepness, J. Cole scolds Noname for not educating him and others in a tone he would prefer, encouraging Noname to be more patient and educate him despite Cole graduating from St. John's University, magnum cum laude, and having greater financial resources to attain such knowledge since his debut. Unlike the April 7th apology to Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole refused to read the room and largely stood by the diss track despite its ill timing and critique from peers. In support of Noname, Chance the Rapper tweeted, "Yet another L for men masking patriarchy and gaslighting as constructive criticism. They both my peoples, but only one of them put out a whole song talking about how the other needs to reconsider their tone and attitude in order to save the world. It's not constructive and undermines all the work Noname has done. It's not black woman's job to spoon feed us. We grown." Despite the misogynoir pinnings of Snow in the Bluff and J. Cole admitting he wasn't a deep prophet like his fans think, the same fan base attacked Noname on social media, unwilling to come to terms with Cole's potential mediocrity.
Then he went and he did a show, I think, the next night or the night after, and I think he digitally imposed my head on top of an Ethiopian's body.
At 14 years old, Queens native and MC Roxanne Shanté was recruited to write a retort track to UTFO's Roxanne Roxanne. The 1984 song was about a woman named Roxanne who declined the hip hop's group romantic courting. Using the original beat or instrumentals from Roxanne Roxanne, Shanté released her track Roxanne's Revenge that would spawn the Roxanne Wars and commence hip hop's first on wax beef. Before 1984, Answer Records existed in hip hop and were foundational to battle rap culture. The Roxanne Wars were unique due to the high number of MCs who responded to Shanté's on wax claims and bravado. It was further important because it proved that beef could not only be culturally significant, but also commercially lucrative for the rappers involved. Since then, rap beefs have populated every decade of hip-hop, synonymous with the culture. At their most noble, it's appeared for rappers to flex their lyricism and showcase how they stand out amongst competitors. When exploited for commercial and media traction, they can turn deadly. Violence moves behind bars, such as the East Coast versus West Coast beef that saw the homicide deaths of Tupac and the Notorious B.I.G. On April 5th, J. Cole released his fourth mixtape, Might Delete Later. The mixtape came weeks after Kendrick Lamar's guest appearance on Metro Booming and Future's We Don't Trust You album, making his vexes known about the Big Three, with this's aim at both Drake and J. Cole on the track Like That. The anticipation for J. Cole and Drake's responses was high, and Cole finally delivered with 7-Minute Drill, the last track on his mixtape, Might Delete Later. From critics and fans, it was underwhelming, with some even questioning Cole's sincerity and dissing Lamar. Arguably, most of his jabs are taken from Rap Twitter's general timeline, and his most intriguing bar, questioning the replay value of To Pimp a Butterfly, Kendrick Lamar's third studio album. His apology and speech at the Dreamville Festival a few days later confirmed speculation and immediately shunned him from the Big Three placement, honestly an exclusion that's been long overdue. In his 2019 single, Middle Child, from Dreamville's compilation album, Revenge of the Dreamers 3, J. Cole rapped, "Back when the rap game was praying I diss, they act like two legends cannot coexist." A clear reference to Kendrick Lamar and Drake. While Lamar and Drake have had a complicated relationship since the release of Good Kid, Mad City, J. Cole has kept an amicable relationship with both men, constantly conceding their greatness in comparison to them. But the respect is mutual, as both Lamar and Drake have publicly praised J. Cole. In 2014, after the release of Cole's 2014 Forest Hills Drive, Kendrick Lamar said, "That's my brother, man. To see that he did exactly what he said he was going to do, and me believing in what he was going to do, is just confirmation that good people will always be blessed." Cole and Drake come from similar backgrounds, both biracial, with thorny relationships with their black dads. Out of the throuple, they seem to hang out the most and announce a collab tour this year. It's okay to recognize J. Cole's vulnerability in bowing out of a race he never belonged, and also think his apology was insanely corny. His conflicted and stressed spirit could have been avoided if he didn't release 7-Minute Drill. Drake hasn't spoken until this weekend with his alleged diss track leak on social media. It's also appropriate to question if Cole would still apologize for 7-Minute Drill if it was better received. Ultimately, this moment is crucial for the ongoing beef because it finally dwindles down the main opponents to just Kendrick Lamar and Drake, which was always going to be the main event. Kendrick Lamar securing what he feels is rightfully his, and Drake tying up loose ends to his bibliography. For hip-hop, the beef and its winner represents a turning point around themes of white consumers, capitalism, and whether black art can exist in its most unfiltered form.
This post is not of journalistic integrity. It's actually a very angry op-ed.
The beating of the drum. And it's time for the Griot Storytelling Circle.